Be informed, SMS your name to 0406 000 UMA.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. I apologize about the delay inshallah in starting or initiating this inshallah, but we'll start inshallah by remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending peace and blessings on the final and most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And tonight, brothers, wallahi, I understand it's cold, I understand it's windy, I understand it's not the best of all environments, but tonight we're with a very special person. A person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Quran, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم النبي أولى بالمؤمنين من أنفسهم, that the messenger is more important to the believers than themselves. He's more valuable, he has more worthy than the believers than themselves. وزوجاته أمهاتهم, that his wives are their mothers. So subhanAllah, tonight we're with a mother of ours. And wallahi, the more I researched on this mother of ours, the more I realized how ignorant we are of this mother. Imagine that you come across a family member that you haven't seen for 5 years or 10 years or 15 years or 20 years. Well, I'll share an incident that happened to me once I went overseas. And there was a funeral. And subhanAllah, sad occasions and happy occasions tend to gather people. So in this funeral, I was introduced to a person, and then someone told me, you know, this is so-and-so. I greeted that person, then someone told me, did you know he was your cousin? And I looked, I said, subhanAllah, no, I didn't. And then he was trying to explain to me how the family tree worked or how this person is really related to me. And I said, subhanAllah, how you could sometimes feel so close to someone just by knowing that he is related to you. And tonight, ikhwani, we're not with a stranger. We're not with a companion. We're not with, you know, a'alim. We are with our mother. Can we put that in our minds? Can we put that in our hearts? We are with our own mother. One of our mothers, Sawda bint Zam'a radiallahu anha wa ardaha. One of the mothers of the believers. One of the mothers of the believers who have sacrificed. One of the many who have sacrificed. One of the companions radiallahu anhu who believed in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at a time when no one else wanted to believe in him. One of the companions who sacrificed her time, her money, her effort in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's who we're with tonight, ikhwani. That's who we're with tonight, sisters. Who is Sawda? Sawda bint Zam'a radiallahu anha. I'll just mention her family lineage. She's Sawda bint Zam'a bint Qais al-Qurashi al-Amiriyya. She's actually from the inhabitants of Mecca, the true inhabitants of Mecca, Ahlul Quraysh, or the people of Quraysh. One of the leading tribes in the Arabian Peninsula. She was known, this is before her Islam, before her marrying to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before her becoming my mother and your mother. She was known to be one of the most righteous people amongst her people. Back then, when there was no standard, when people didn't know right from wrong, before the message of Islam even came, people who were living in darkness, he's a lady who knew how to deal with people, how to give people their rights, how to not offend people, how to be just with people, subhanAllah, just on the fitrah. She married a man by the name of As-Sakran ibn Amr. And this man wasn't really famous. However, his brother was extremely famous. His name is Suhail ibn Amr, radiallahu anhu. This man was a man who done the treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam nearly a decade later. A decade later in a treaty called Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. With this treaty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has upholded Islam and made it gave Islam the chance to spread its wings in the Arabian Peninsula. The brother of this person was by the name of As-Sakran ibn Amr, a very old man, a very fragile man. Here he is hearing the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he accepts the shahada and he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Here we have As-Sakran ibn Amr and his wife Sawda bint Zam'a, a house that believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a house that worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the middle of Mecca. At what time? What era, ikhwani? We're not talking about Sydney, Australia, where people will accept you for who you are, and there's multiculturalism, and there's, you know, a multi-faith room, and a multi-faith dialogue. No, ikhwani. We're talking about Mecca, at the peak of persecution. We're talking about Mecca, at the peak when, if they knew someone became a Muslim, his own family would disown this person. And the people around him will put pressure on this person to leave Islam. And so many of them were martyred, and so many of them were jailed, and so many of them were kicked out of their homes, and so many of them lost their houses and children and everything they owned. This is what we're talking about. This is the environment that they were living in, ikhwani. SubhanAllah, today, wallahi, and I'm proud to say it, we see brothers even and sisters, even in this center, in many mosques, many centers, saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. You might feel a bit of, you know, you might feel, or you might, yani, get scared of them from their surroundings, people, yani, putting pressure on them. But it is nowhere near the pressure that was placed on the Muslims when they accepted Islam back at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we're talking about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam in the initial years of da'wah, the initial years of calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the initial years of Islam in Mecca. Where today me and you can come to a center, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pray, listen to a talk, a lecture, go to many other talks and lectures, and no one can persecute you. Back then, Bilal radiallahu anhu, just to give you an example, Bilal radiallahu anhu was tortured so much that he said, I felt like my soul was going to come out of my throat for saying, Ahadun Ahad, Allah is one. That's what Bilal said. Ahadun Ahad. Ahadun Ahad, so they tortured him, and they tortured him, and they tortured him, and he was insistent on Ahadun Ahad. Compare that to my status and my situation and your situation today. So, ikhwani, we should make the most of the, yani, the luxury that we have, if I may use the word. The fact that we could worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in peace. Wallahi, it is a ni'mah, it is a bounty. That only those who have been deprived of it know what it's worth. So here's Sawda bint Zam'a, believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believing in the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca, under the torture, under the tyranny, when they'll take away your money, when they'll take away your children away from you and enslave them, where they'll kick you out of your house, where they'll harm you, where Sumayya radiallahu anhu was executed and killed. This is the situation they were in. Imagine the situation in Mecca, and these Muslims, all they want to do is worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told a group of the believers, لَوْ خَرَجْتُمْ إِلَىٰ أَرْضِ الْحَبَشَةِ. You should go and migrate to the kingdom of Ethiopia, or the Ethiopian land. فَإِنَّ فِيهَا مَلِكًا لَا يُظْلَمُ عُنْدَهُ أَحَدًا. That there's a king there, no one will be ruled unjustly under his kingdom. Was this king Muslim? No, he wasn't. Was this king related to Islam somehow? Did he have a peace treaty with the Muslims? No. He was a Christian king. However, he upheld justness in his kingdom. And that's the in that, ikhwani, there's a lesson for us. If there's someone out there who deals with justice, he could be from a different faith. You could actually work with him. You could look after him. He could look after you should there be a need. Should the need rise, you could work together on certain issues. Just like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him some of the main companions radiallahu anhu. He sent him Uthman radiallahu anhu. He sent him his own daughter Ruqayya radiallahu anha to where? To Al-Habasha. Amongst the people who migrated, ikhwani, under the pressure, imagine the persecution. Compare it to the persecution that's going on in Syria. Why do we hear about refugees? Because of the persecution. Why would someone leave his house? Leave his wife, leave his family, leave everything he owns. It's a persecution, it's a killing, it's a murdering, it's a torture, it's unjustness, it's a tyranny. So here we have families migrating in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amongst these families, Ikhwani, was a very special and a very important family. As-Sakran ibn Amr wa Sawda bint Zam'a radiyallahu anhu. The couple, the worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, also migrated in the path of Allah. And Ikhwani, when I say migrate in the path of Allah, it's not like me and you packing our bags and going to Melbourne or going to another city or another town for a holiday where we know we're going to come back. When I say migrate in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what I'm talking about is you leaving your house, leaving all your finances, leaving all your trade, leaving all your friends, leaving all your family, leaving everything that you own and you don't own, leaving your whole life behind you and going to somewhere that you don't know what's ahead of you. You don't know what you're going to face. That's what migration in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means. Can you do it? Brother, by Allah, can you do it for the sake of Allah? Sister, if you're listening to me, by Allah, can you migrate in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Would it be easy to migrate in the path of Allah? This is what hijrah means, Ikhwani. This is what it means to migrate in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they migrated, left everything behind them. Their whole lives, their money, their children, their work, their colleagues. Imagine leaving your whole life and going to a whole new country, a whole new continent for that matter. Going to Ethiopia. And here they are in Ethiopia, the Muslims, strangers, a minority, people who always had looked after themselves, who prided themselves of having, you know, family ties and, you know, etc. and being known. Here they are, they're strangers. They've got no family, no friends. All they have is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the years go past. And here they are in Ethiopia, hoping to hear anything about Mecca. Imagine you're living in a country or you're in a place, in a location, but your mind, your heart, your soul is in a different location altogether. That was their condition. They were waiting for anything from the people of Mecca. Any news, anything to give them hope about Mecca, about what's happening to Mecca, what's happening to the Prophet, any news about the, you know, the message of Islam. And once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these people in Ethiopia were waiting for anything. So once they heard a rumor that the people of Mecca had become Muslims, and the reason behind the rumor was very simple. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was once sitting down next to the Kaaba, with the Kaaba to his, you know, to his back, and he was reciting the Quran. And subhanallah, as I said earlier, the persecution, the torture, the naming and shaming of Islam and Muslims was so bad that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself did not escape this torture. That so many times, wherever he would recite the Quran or call people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the kuffar will make sure someone's following him to make sure that no one listens to him. They'll say, don't listen to this magician, don't listen to this person, don't listen to him. He will, you know, put a spell on you, and so on and so forth. And here he is, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reciting Quran in the haram, next to the Kaaba, with no interruptions. One of the fewest times that he was not interrupted, that there wasn't someone screaming out and yelling out. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam began to recite, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wan najmi idha hawa. ما ضل صاحبكم وما غوى وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued to recite from Surah Al-Najm. And he continued to recite, and the verses, Ikhwani, who's reciting? It's a message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is he reciting? He's reciting the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل. If we sent down this Quran on a mountain, you find this mountain shaking from the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the words of Allah being recited by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam next to the Kaaba. Imagine the effect. Imagine the effect of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So who was listening? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was reciting to the Muslims. The non-Muslims were sitting in groups and gatherings, and they were tuning in. They were in the earlier gatherings, but they were tuning in. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued reciting, all you can hear is the words of the Quran being recited. No one else spoke. While he's reciting, everyone else went silent. No one would say a word. If you drop the pin, you can hear it. And the Prophet ﷺ continued to recite until he reached a verse. أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ Are you amazed from this speech? From the Qur'an. وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ And you laugh and do not cry. The Qur'an here was addressing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was talking to the non-believers. That you're laughing about Islam, you're laughing about the Qur'an, you're laughing about the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَعْبُدُوا So prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship Him. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited that verse, he done sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Muslims followed by doing sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who was also tuning in? The non-Muslims, the kuffar. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were so powerful that these non-Muslims, these people who did not believe in Allah or the hereafter or the book or the Quran, also prostrated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and done sujood. So much so that there was an old man, an old non-Muslim. He could not bow down, he could not do sujood from having a bad back of some sort. So he grabbed some sand and he put it on his head and said, Ya Allah, is this enough? Qat, Ya Allah, Qat, is this enough? Is this enough? Ikhwani, can you see the power of the Quran? People in that gathering, the news spread throughout the Arabian Peninsula, then it spread to parts of the world. Part of that is Ethiopia. They heard about them non-Muslims doing sujood, so they thought that the non-Muslims have become Muslims. That the whole of Mecca, when they done sujood, became Muslims. And that wasn't true. After this incident, some people accepted Islam, some people didn't. They sort of snapped out of it and thought, hey, no, we only done sujood out of respect for the word of Allah, the word Allah mentioned in the what Muhammad was reciting, and so on. And here you have the people in Ethiopia, they heard a rumor that the Kuffar of Quraysh became Muslim, they decided to come back. As they traveled to Khwani, and we're talking about very old people, Sawda bint Zam'a radiallahu anhu, my mother and your mother, was at the age of 60. Imagine a 60-year-old. And Khwani, a 60-year-old living in the deserts of Arabia, is very different to a 60-year-old living in the luxury of Sydney, Australia. So the desert has taken its toll, and then moving to a country like Ethiopia back then, would have also taken its toll with the travel. So imagine a six-year-old with a very old husband. Here they are traveling back to Australia, to Afwan, Mecca. And going back to Mecca, Ikhwani. What? They went through the hardship of travel. And on the way, they found out that the Kuffar of Quraysh did not become Muslim. However, it was just an incident. So some of these people decided to go back, and some of them decided to continue. Amongst those who continued was Sawda bint Zam'a radiallahu anha and her husband. Everyone that continued had protection within Mecca. For you to enter Mecca or any of those cities back then, you needed to have some kind of protection. Someone who will protect you. They used to call it Jiwar. If I give you protection, no one can harm you knowing that you're in my protection. I need to be a person of nobility, of status, of power, of money. So they used to ask people for protection, and people will feel proud to give people protection, so to speak. So here they are, everyone managed to get their protection, their insurance policy, except for Sawda bint Zam'a, a mother, and her husband, As-Sakran ibn Amr. And they said, we are in the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are in the jawar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they entered Mecca. And Ikhwani, what they go back to? The land of torture. Where Muslims are being tied to trees and they're being executed. Where Muslims, just like today, are being killed in Syria, they were also killed in Mecca. Where Muslims are being buried alive. Where Sumayya radiallahu anha was stabbed with a spear in her private part and executed. And the executions went on. When Bilal radiallahu anha was placed, where a large rock was placed on Bilal and so many others. Where one of the companions was dragged, was tied up with his neck with a rope. And he was given to little children and they would drag him around Mecca to play with him and laugh. And his blood would fill the corners of Mecca. This is what Mecca was like. The holiest place on earth. This is what these people will come back to. This is what Sawda radiallahu anha was come back to. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected her as she was in his jawab. In his protection. And who is a better protector than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Today, me and you, and so many Muslims and non-Muslims, when they need protection, people run to a bank. Some others would run to an institution. Some others would run to left and right and center. Run to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is your real protector. And هيدا يا إخواني in Mecca. And Sawda رضي الله عنها saw a dream. It was an interesting dream. She says in the dream that she's in a particular place where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking and he steps on her neck. So in the morning, when next day she met with her husband, she told him, I saw this dream where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stepped on my neck. So he told her, if your dream is true, then I am to die and you are to marry the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So subhanAllah, her mind didn't work out in her mind. How can I possibly ever marry the Prophet? A very old woman. She wasn't the most good looking woman. She had no money. She had no family ties. She wasn't one of the famous families or one of the strongest families. Nothing. Why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam marry someone like me? And it was only a matter of days and her husband passes away. And here she is living in the house of her father and her brothers who are non-Muslims. That's all happening with Sawda radiallahu anha, our mother. Let's talk about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What was he going through? SubhanAllah, we're talking about a couple, ikhwani. We're not really talking about one person, we're talking about a couple. Sawda radiallahu anha marrying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What was happening with him? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the most beautiful relationship with his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. The mother of his children. The one that shared love with him. The one that shared his life, its sweetness and its bitterness. The one that lived with him and supported him internally and externally, emotionally and financially, in every possible way, Khadija radiallahu anha supported the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And here she is in the year of sadness, Amul Huzn. In this year, can you believe it, that the most beloved person to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passes away? Khadija. Not only that, his uncle passes away, Abu Talib, the man who used to protect him. Not only that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes to At-Ta'if to call people to Islam, so they start stoning him. So much so that he got stoned from his head to his toe. That his shoes, his sandals were stuck to his feet from how much blood came on them and dried. Can you imagine it? Have we done 10% of that, ikhwani? Have we even done 1%? Have we done 1% of the 1% in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The year of sadness. One of the saddest years in the times of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah, it was one of those years where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who's known to be a cheery person, a happy person, a strong person, the companions radiallahu anhum noticed his emotional state deteriorate, so to speak. And feel, he wasn't himself. This is a few months after Khadija radiallahu anha passed away. Who's at home? He's got his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha, she was about 8 or 9 years old, and he had his daughter as well, Umm Kulthum radiallahu anha. And Umm Kulthum she done her katb kitab or her marriage contract with one of the children of Abi Lahab. However, he divorced her just to get back at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. He's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's in the house, he's got his children. He needs to deliver the message that was given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He needs to pass on La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah to the people. However, he's finding it difficult as he's emotionally not in the best of states. He's passing on the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's meeting with the people, calling people to Allah, doing his job. But people have noticed that he's not feeling himself. So one of the companions radiallahu anhu, and a female. And ikhwani, in this, we take a step back and look at the job of females in the message of Islam. Did you know that the first martyr in Islam was a woman? Did you know that the first person who believed in the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a woman? Did you know that so many people, so many females had some of the major roles in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his life? And here comes a woman. Khawla bint Hakim radiallahu anha, one of the companions. She sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as she was looking after Fatima and she was looking after Umm Kulthum. She sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's not himself. So she tells him, Ya Rasulallah. And she was married to one of the companions who told her, go and speak to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. She told him, Ya Rasulallah, ala tatazawaj? O messenger, don't you want to get married? Basically saying, look, we see how you feel, you should get married. Ya Rasulullah, ala tatazawaj? Don't you want to get married? So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not respond. Khawla looked at him and said, Ya Rasulullah, ala tatazawaj, a messenger, don't you want to get married? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam froze and he did not respond. So for the third time she said it. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had tears in his eyes. Who is he? He's one of the strongest men that the face of the earth has seen. Had tears in his eyes and he said, Awa ba'da Khadija? Is there anyone after Khadija? This is months, ikhwani, months after the death of Khadija. Awa ba'da Khadija? Anyone after Khadija? So Khawla, this woman who was asking the Prophet, she said in herself, I wish I never spoke to him. But then she started, she needs to finish off her job. So she said, Ya Rasulullah, man lil bayti wal iyal? Who look after your house? Who look after your children? You're a messenger of Allah. You have the duty to deliver the message of Allah to people. Who look after your household, your kids, your children, your females? So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam froze and said, basically, what you have? So she told him, if you want, I could find you a young virgin, you know, beautiful, you know, and she described beautiful qualities. Or if you want, I could find you someone who's been married before, whatever it is that you want. So he asked her, the one that's been married, who do you have in mind? She said, Sawda bint Zam'a, our mother. Ikhwani, when I say the name Sawda bint Zam'a, she was known to be not the prettiest of all females. She was known to be one of the poorest people. There's no money there. Not from a family, a big family, not famous, not, you know, of a status of nobility, nothing. وَلَكِنَّهَا آمَنَتْ بِكَ. But she believed in Allah and your message. What does that do to her, ikhwani? That raises her rank, raises who she is, you know, above the stars. But she believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in your message. So it raised her status beyond the stars, ikhwani, beyond the galaxy, beyond as far as it goes. What's a woman be without Islam, without the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if she has beauty, or she has money, or she has status, or she has power, or she comes from a particular family, but she has no religion? Ikhwani, she is weightless. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says in the hadith, tunkahul mar'a, that a woman gets married for four reasons. For her beauty, that a man would marry a woman for four reasons. For her beauty, for her family and tribe and what, you know, status, social status she has. For her money, financial status. ولدينها, for her religion. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, فَظْفَرَ. You know, like when there's a war between two countries and one wins, it's called, we call it ظَفَرَ. You know, the one, win the one with religion. تَبِبَتْ يَدَكْ. May your hands perish, or may your hand not touch the ground. Basically, so you don't become a loser. If you don't want to be a loser, make sure you marry the one with religion. And if you're already married, make sure your wife is a woman of religion and endorse that religion in her. Do not marry a woman without religion, ikhwani. It's like marrying an empty house, or an empty body, or a body with no soul. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, here he is. He's a 50-year-old. He still has the you know, the desire. He's still a male. He's still got emotions. So he told her, go. Let's go for Sawda bint Zam'a. So they go and approach the father of Sawda, and the marriage goes ahead. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam marries an older woman, marries a not very pretty woman, marries a woman with no attractions, but La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. And subhanAllah, this woman was so sincere. Our mother Sawda radiallahu anha was so sincere that she had the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam all for herself for 3 years. This did not happen or occur to anyone after Khadija except for Sawda bint Zam'a radiallahu anha. She had him all for herself for 3 years. And subhanAllah, at the time of sadness, in the midst of the darknesses, in the midst of the sadness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in Aamul Huzn, the year of sadness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends him this woman. She's older than him, yeah, that's true. But she was known to be the most light-hearted woman at that time. She was always smiling. Today, subhanAllah, our females, with all the luxury and all the money and all the latest technology and the iPhones and the iPads and, you know, all the eyes, and you hardly see a smile on a female's face. And the woman back then had so much hardship. And he's the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be, her quality is known to be the smiley one, the one that constantly smiles, always happy, very cheery. Do we have that in our females today? SubhanAllah. Very happy. And SubhanAllah, she was able to make the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam happy in the midst of his sad times. In the hardest of times, she was there for him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She'd sit down and talk to him and alleviate some of the hardships of the message. Whenever he'll go out and call the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and come back home, he'll find her there to cuddle him, to look after him, just to hug him and look after his needs, just to be there for him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as he was a human being after all. And from that, a very special message to the sisters. Your husband out there has a very hard life, may it be at work, may it be at studies, whatever it is that he does. When he comes home, make your house your sanctuary. Make it the place where he can relax. Make it the place where he can get closer to you. Make it the place where he can feel at home, not with strangers. Just like Sawda radiallahu anha made the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam feel so comfortable. She had, ikhwani, a very interesting sense of humor. Once she was praying behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and just to make the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam laugh after the prayer or smile, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam done a lot of rukua, a lot of sujood, a lot of prostration, a lot of, you know, sujood. So she told him, "Ya Rasulullah, I prayed behind you and I was going to hold my nose in fear of bleeding. So much for my nose, so much, that's how much rukua and sujood you done." We may not find it funny, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam smiled from that. And subhanAllah, she was always looking for ways to entertain the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, just to alleviate the hem of this life on him. And subhanAllah, she was not placed in a test. As she got older, ikhwani, she knew that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved his wife Aisha radiallahu anha so much. And for those who may not find this, yani, may not understand this, I don't blame you. She was, Sawda radiallahu anha was so in love with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that whatever made him happy, made her happy. I'll repeat that, just in case someone didn't get me. This person, Sawda radiallahu anha, our mother, was so in love with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whatever made him happy, made her happy. Even if she compromised her time with him. So she gave up her night with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She gave it to Aisha because she knew he'll be happier with her. And that made her happier. SubhanAllah, it's a different level of love altogether, ikhwani. That she knows that he's happy, therefore I'll be happy. So I gave it in the path of Allah. And here she is, ikhwani, in Medina, living in worship, living with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, living in maybe the hardest of conditions, supporting the da'wah, but living the life of a true mujahida, a lady who sacrificed in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She migrated from Mecca to Ethiopia, then they went back, and then here she is migrating to Medina, where she lived the remainder of her life, and then she passed away, rahimahullah. And then she was buried in Al-Baqiyah. So whenever you go, the Al-Baqiyah is the graveyard which is next to the Prophet's mosque sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So whenever you go, when you say salams to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when you say salams to Abu Bakr, to Umar, to all the other companions, do you ever forget to send salams to your own mother, Sawda bint Zam'a radiallahu anha, a name that we find strange, but she's your mother at the end of the day. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that didn't allow us to see our mother in this world, to allow us to see her in the hereafter, to allow our sisters to follow her footsteps, and to allow our brothers to open up their eyes and marry the ones with religion, and make sure and make them understand the value of religion in a woman, and make the ones with that are already married, let their wives have more religion in their lives. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who listen, understand, and implement. إني داع فأمنه اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم. Oh Allah have mercy on the Muslims ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah have mercy on the Muslims ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah have mercy on the Muslims ya Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah be with our brothers and sisters in Syria and be with our brothers and sisters in Iraq and Palestine and Gaza and Al-Aqsa ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah be with the refugees. Be with the ones in prisons. Be with the ones in the hardest of conditions. Oh Allah, allow our houses to have happiness in it. Allow our hearts to have happiness in it. Allow our minds to settle and have happiness. Allow our lives to have happiness ya Rabbil Alameen. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وجزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته